He's my replacement. Nice young man.
That was pretty neat. Time for the Pledge of Allegiance. Betty.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Follow me in order. Everybody is present. Is there a motion to approve the agenda?
Move to approve.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Public comment. We've had enough public comment from approval of the minutes. We need, first of all, a motion and a second for the April 14th, 2015 regular board meeting.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
The April 27th, 2015 organizational meeting.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Dave.
Okay. That takes us to communications, and we'll begin with the New York City choir trip and slideshow. And Ms. Kathy Allen, our choir director, is here, and with a couple students, I think. So
yes.
I will run the show as soon as you tell
Perfect.
Me to go.
I like that.
All right.
Thank you. For those of you who haven't met me, I'm Kathy Allen, and it's been a pleasure. It's been a fun year, a challenging year. And we just came back from one of our big endeavors, our New York City choir trip, where we performed in the Heritage Music Festival. And I have Joe Gill and Nate Schuler-Jones. They agreed to come along so that they can give you a little spin on the student's perspective on this as soon as I'm done with the slideshow. So, actually, some of the pictures are from Sherry Wisey, who was one of the chaperones that went along, as well as Kira Morrison, that took some of these great photos. New York City was the first time I've taken a trip with students to New York City. I've been there myself, and I've done many, many trips, but never New York, so it was a great new experience for me as well.
Maybe we could get some of those lights now.
For you to see better, yeah. Okay, so we were part of the Heritage Music Festival, which Dan Wolfgram had done for many years at Riverside Church. Cats Choir performed, vocal jazz ensemble, and madrigal, which is the same group of mad jazzers. They each did a set of vocal jazz and a set of chamber music. So there are three groups that performed. And you'll just see some shots here is when we first arrived at the church and then warming up in the chapel with vocal jazz. It's a beautiful church. And the comments and scores from the adjudicators, we came home and I forgot to bring the plaques. The plaques, we came home with two silvers and one gold. And the concert choir received a silver, but if you notice, you had to have a 90 or above cumulative score, and we were right underneath that with 86, 89, and a 91 for concert choir, which is the excellent or superior level, if you're over 90. So just some comments, nice vibrant sound, excellent work listening to each other. She wrote, this particular judge wrote, consider opening their mouths more to low for more heightened vowels, so that's a technical thing. Good rhythm and the choice of music, she just wrote, wow. Mad jazz for singing the jazz portion, and the lady who came up and adjudicated with them was one of the founding members of the Manhattan Transfer, and gave some great critique for them. And then one of the other judges wrote, beautiful shimmery sound, an outstanding blend, which I agree. Very fine repertoire, great diversity of songs, stay connected with free, full airflow. And this was the main thing that the lady that came up and worked with them was, keep smiling, keep communicating, bring your performance out to the audience instead of keeping it right there with your group. So it was all good comments there. Some more pictures after they were done. Standing out in front of the beautiful church. It was really a beautiful church. And just a few more. Just singing in that space itself was just amazing. highlights? Joe, what was one of the highlights when you guys went to warm, after warm-ups?
Well, we had a music, we had a music-making shop, and what happened was we had a Broadway, a person that was on, an actor that was on Broadway for Les Mis came in and worked with us throughout the morning. It was one of the coolest experiences of my life.
Yeah, I worked with Bob Rogers Travel, and it was a suggestion to do this making music workshop at this particular company. And both the music director at the piano and the gentleman who's one of the cast members of Les Miserables, they're fantastic with the kids. Really, really worked with them like on a professional level, made them step up, and this is what it's like when you come to one of our rehearsals, and the kids didn't hold back at all. And both of them and one of the people from the company that was there as well, just observing, said that our group was well beyond many of their high school groups that they work with. It felt like they were just up on an upper level, and they could take them much further than they normally do in workshops. That was really fun too. Kids seemed to love it. Just some highlights of pictures, places we went. Some we saw Wicked. Many people went to Phantom or Les Miserables, Aladdin, Lion King, or Jersey Boys, one of the different shows that they could choose from. One of the highlights for the bus that I was on was we went to Central Park on our tour, and we were at the Strawberry Fields John Lennon Memorial, and there was a gentleman who's in the top right corner playing guitar and singing Beatles songs. And our kids started joining in with him and singing harmony, and he jumped to another song and he encouraged them to sing along, and they had the best time just singing, making music with this street performer, and he enjoyed it as well. So, and then Radio City Music Hall is right there in the middle. We did tour that. And Times Square, which I had my fill of two times there for a couple hours each time. I had enough of that place. Crazy. Just way too much there. And then on the far right bottom, that boat was the boat that we took as part of the Heritage Festival. After the award ceremony wrap up, they had a dinner and a dance cruise for the kids. Kids seemed to have a good time on that. Something that I really, really wanted the students to experience, as well as myself, was the 9/11 Memorial Museum, now that it is open. And we spent a whole morning in that part of the city, and I really felt, if you haven't seen it yet, it's beautifully done, very respectful, very interesting, keeps your interest throughout. And then of course the pools that everyone has heard about are very beautiful. And the new tower is on the left there that we get to see as well. The last day in New York, we went to St. John the Divine, another thing that Dan had done in years past and was really amazing, the world's largest Gothic cathedral. And we sang a half an hour performance there. And there was quite a few people gathered around while we were singing. And then if you go to the next slide, there's some pictures. We did the vertical tour where you go up into the bellows and actually above the ceiling, get up into the rafters, which they call the woods, the ceiling of it. And the middle picture, we're probably two-thirds of the way up. You can see down how far that is. It's quite amazing. So down on the floor level, there are some of us by a baptismal font, and that was climbing up, and then on the far right was a group way up on the rooftop, and the ladies were about 12 stories up. You just climbed through this little spiral staircase to get to the top. Very interesting. And we ended our trip at the Empire State Building. We got there about, do you remember what time?
About 6:37 o'clock,
and we were there for a couple hours. We got to be there from daylight through until it was just about dark, and it was a really amazing time to be there and watch the change of the way the city looks when we were there. And then after that, we hopped on the bus and made the long ride home. And so those are all the students that participated in the trip, as well as myself and Ms. Morrissey. We had 59 singers, and we had 9 parents that went along, all wonderful parents that really helped out a lot. And then myself and Ms. Morrissey. It was a fantastic experience. And I just wanted to thank you for making that something that happens every other year, and then opposite year for the band, because I feel that travel is a wonderful learning experience for students, many who would not travel and have those experiences otherwise. So much learning goes on when you travel. Even the fact that we had to you know, learn to live with the fact we had little bus issues and maybe not outlets to plug in their devices and had a little compressor issue on one of the buses and things. I kept telling the kids, things happen when you go on trips. Sometimes you don't make your plane or something breaks down with your car or your reservations don't hold up at the hotel. You just make it work. And I think we all really bonded and we made it work and everybody had a good time. The devices after a while was not a big deal. I know on my bus they were singing and playing games and dealing with each other instead of on some other foreign device. So anything you want to share, Nate, or even Isaac that's here. Isaac also went. Isaac, right?
I know, it's super cool to be able to sing in Riverside and St. John's. Our sound was amazing, mm-hmm. especially for like jazz. Jazz was cool and chamber sounded just great. It's a pretty awesome experience to be able to sing in a place like that.
Yeah, I agree.
I would say before I went, I was looking forward to the shows. That was one of the biggest things I was looking forward to. And as Nate said, when I got into the cathedral, I just said, all right, let's just run through this and continue on with our day. And it's an experience I'll never have again in my life. And it was by far the best experience of my life, singing. And with the reverb of the church, oh gosh, you'd sing a note and you'd hear it 2 seconds later. It was the craziest thing ever.
Yeah, that St. John the Divine has an 8-second reverb, so finish a chord and you hear it for a while. It's great. Neat experience. So, yeah, very neat. Anything else? You guys were telling me things in my office today.
Oh, yeah, just the 9/11 memorial was amazing. Like, I don't think anybody can go through that without crying. It was really, really sad. Like, really glad we got to see it. I learned a lot. It was really, really cool. It was well done. Really respectful the way they did it too. Mm-hmm. They don't let you like take pictures of any of the people that were involved in the accident. And like it was just amazing.
Yep.
How far they've come, but like you can still see all the effects today, and how people feel about it. It's just. It's hard to believe that it happened, but I'm glad that we got to go and see it. Mm-hmm. Good learning experience.
Yeah, and they were in my office after school today. We were talking about just the bonding that happened, mm-hmm. the bonding that takes place with the students and how close they get in that few days. So again, we just want to thank you, and we just want to share some of our experience. Not quite the same as being there, but a little bit of our experience with you. Thank you. And we hope you can come to our concert on Sunday afternoon. 30.
Thank you. Yes. Thank you very much. Yeah. We move on to recognition. In your packet were a list of the winter sports coaches and athletes who were recognized for their accomplishments. Congratulations to them. And there was a letter from the PBIS coordinator or evaluator, I should say, at DPI came to visit the WLC and wrote a letter of appreciation to the WLC for their implementation of the PBIS program. Donations, ThetaCare to WLC, $500, and there was an employee, I believe, of ThetaCare who designated WLC as a recipient of those volunteer monies. Assembly of God pays fees and school supplies to students who are unable to pay them on their own. FFA Kids Against Hunger, they ran that program again this year. Congratulations to them. And there's a list of all the donors who participated in that program. Rotary Education Grant, Mr. Biba approached the Rotary and said he's in need of some funds for tuba. And because of all the work Mr. Biba and Ms. Shana Rogney do for the Rotary, they came up with $1,000 to give to the middle school band, in addition to the $10,000 they hand out earlier in the year. So that was a nice gift to them. Someone who had some service done and Waupaca High School Service Day donated $25 to the high school for the work done in their yard. And then Waupaca Middle School had a fun run this past Friday. And there's a list in the back of all the donors for that run. grill, and do you have any idea how much money was raised?
We raised about $4,000 from the run, and it was a perfect day for it. Everybody had a good time. And
that's your first one at middle school?
This is our second one.
Second one. Right.
Last year we had one, and this is our second one. Went very well. Perfect day for it.
And what are the proceeds?
We use it for our Lyceum account, which goes for anything from athletics to activities. So we're purchasing band stuff or athletics. We'll have programs, technology, have anything that we can't get with our regular budget. This will go above and beyond for those things.
Is that managed by a parent group then, or?
No, this one goes through our Fund 21.
Okay. So we'll need a motion to approve those donations.
Is there a motion to approve?
So moved. With appreciation.
Second.
Is it called for a
just a roll call?
Sure. Roll call?
Yes.
Okay. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm trying to read and talk at the same time. No, it's a voice.
It's pretty tough, isn't it?
It is.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
If Dave doesn't know what we're doing, really.
Yeah, we are really.
And I'm sitting here waiting. What are we waiting for here?
Then the next item, I'll take the first couple on the school board. We have a resolution. CISA 5 is asking to purchase a building called Fort Winnebago Elementary School. It's in Portage, and that school runs a program like our Waupaca County Charter School. The Portage District is no longer in need of that building. In order for CISA 5 to purchase it, they need permission from all the schools in CISA 5, even though it will not cost us any money. This is not a cost to us to handle it through the program. We did this a couple of years ago. Sandy, you may have been involved at that time. Do you remember?
I'm sure I was.
We purchased a different building in, I think it was up near Wisconsin Rapids. So it's a resolution authorizing, giving your permission for them to buy that building.
So move for approval.
Second.
Voice.
All in favor?
Aye.
Teacher contracts. Listed on the documentation online were a list of all the teachers who are receiving contracts. There are no surprises or anything unusual there. But at your place in the upper right hand corner is a copy of the actual contract that's going out to each of the teachers. It's a one page document on both sides. I'd just like to point out a couple changes that were made in that contract this year compared to last year. Act 10 said that only full time teachers are covered by State Statute 118.22, which covers the contracting of teachers. The full-time teachers are not. In the past, we used the same contract for both full-time and part-time. And then that requires us to non-renew a part-time teacher because they're included under 118.22. This contract splits it out and says this only covers full-time teachers where part-time teachers are not. And that's the last paragraph, or last sentence in the fourth paragraph that says it does not apply to them. So that was just clarified. Then the other change has to do with the liability. If you remember, we used to start way back in May or so, once contracts were issued, if there was someone trying to get out of a contract or early, we had penalties for $200, $300, escalated up to $500. When the law changed, the contracts are not due until the end of May, so it's pretty hard to penalize somebody prior to the contracts being due. So this contract changed the amounts that used to start at $200, $300. By the time they got to August or the end of June, they were at $400. So that's where this contract starts, at $400. Then after, in August, just like before, it's $500, with the district maintaining the right to not release someone until it's in August or later, the right not to release that teacher until a qualified substitute is found. So those are the changes to this contract. They're then due back by June 1st. And and that's it. So what we'll need is a motion to authorize issuance of contracts to the listed teachers.
I would move that we authorize contracts to the listed teachers.
I'll second. Dave, when then will we, or will you be issuing these?
Tomorrow.
Tomorrow. And my other question before we move on, is there, what would a part-time person then receive that would be?
They'll receive this contract, but if you, that last sentence, it pulls out, says section 118.22 does not apply to the extent this is a part-time contract. So they receive the same contract.
Same contract, okay.
Before, that wasn't in there, so they automatically fell under 118.22 because of that.
Is there a motion to approve?
There has been a motion and a second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Does Pat get one of those things, one of those contracts?
Well, I hope so. I'll make sure my name's on the list.
That takes a school visit.
School visit. Anybody make any school visits?
I did. I went to the alternative school today and had quite a lengthy, nice visit with Mrs. Bloomberg and Chuck Peters, Mr. Peters. And there were 7 or 8 students in the classroom. Actually, it intersected 2 class times, so there was some changing that went back and forth. But I had a very nice chat with how the program is going and the differences in the program when it was next door and now that it's at the high school, and the pros and cons, and there are certainly a lot more benefits, I think, from moving there than when it was here. It seems that with the program at the high school now, it's not as isolated as it used to be. There, many more of the students are mainstreaming into the classes, the different classes, and so they're spending only 1 hour or 2 or 3 in the alternative classroom and then moving on into the other classes. Most of their students are graduating, and the graduates go through the traditional graduation ceremony that we have, whereas my time to visit the school is always in May. And so in the past when I visited over there, they were having their own little graduation ceremonies that were being put together. And so now the students go through our traditional program. They said as far as students that attend that program and go into normal classrooms, it's easier because someone used to have to drive them or they would drive themselves from here to there. There were stops along the way sometimes, and now there's not because they can go directly to a classroom. And they've learned to adapt to the program. Interestingly, all the students that are in the program now have no recollection of when the program was here. So it's easier for them. They said the transition, 2-year transition was, you know, a little harder on those kids. Some of the cons to the program, they said, is that they're more transparent, that you know, some of those students just have bad memories or bad vibes about their time in the traditional type of schooling, and so when it was here, it was a total different environment. But like all things, you learn to live with it and get up and over it, so anyway. They talked a lot about the GED program that's now available. It's called GEDO 2, I believe, that's available for young people when they're short of some credits to graduate. And instead of taking that class and passing it, they can take the equivalent of a GED exam. It's very stringent. For a school district to be able to use that, they have to go through a lengthy application process. The students still have to have 10 to 15 hours of class time a week in that subject, and then they are taken to Stevens Point or Fox Valley here to take that exam. And I guess I never realized it, but the GED exam, it's a difficult exam, and they said it's geared so that 40% of those that take it might not pass it because it is pretty stringent. You can only maintain your ability to be part of that program if you have an 80% success rate. So 80% of your students that take the test have to pass it, or they won't approve your district as a district that can go into this program. And Waupaca has done well, and we were able to be part of the program for quite some time. So anyway, it was very insightful as to the different ways that the students learn. They did say that with our new academic standards that are going in, that it will, while it will help many college-bound students, it will perhaps present one more obstacle for kids on the edge that are trying to accumulate credits. But actually, they realize that some of their students do go on and go to college. And they're realizing now that many of the students that are in the program are actually very intelligent students, and there's a lack of motivation for whatever reason. Interestingly enough, Mr. Peters was telling me, he just read a book, he said he would know about it, about why boys lack motivation. There's a book out now, coming out, about why girls lack motivation too. But a lot of it is environmental and physiological. And so they're finding that things in our environment, plastics, things, you know, that we absorb are affecting ways kids learn and what motivates them to do what they do. So anyway, I learned a lot. It was really a nice visit, and both of the teachers in that classroom were delighted to sit down and be able to share what they're doing and the progress of their kids, and the students were really proud, I think, to be able to kind of showcase what they do. So I went to that, and then several of us went to the open house for the Live program.
Mary Jo Barton's.
Yes. Remember our last meeting, we had that, and so many of us were there at that open house, which was so awesome to go there and see the students and see the program and see the room that was outfitted by Hanson's and whatever. So that was a great visit too.
Do you have your caricature done?
No, I didn't. Did you? Really? Does it look like her?
Oh, it'd be a...
The student that was doing them was not there when we were there, because he was going, or Sandy and I were there. He went to Fox Valley. He had a class that night, so he had left. But I couldn't believe his work, how good it was.
Well, I'll just follow up on that. I went to the Live program today. I had run over to school.
For coffee?
No, I didn't have coffee, although they were... there was nobody in the room when I I dropped in, so she called, the secretary called Mary Jo, and she came down. But she took me through it all, mm-hmm. and she told me that most of the board members had been there, except me, and so I was happy to go today. But it was really nice. I mean, all of you know that were there, that, you know, wonderful accommodations, and the furniture, gosh, you know, I didn't hate it to sit down.
It's like walking into a furniture.
Yeah, really, very, very nice. So it was really nice, and she took a lot of time to talk to me about it. She had one boy with her today, she says her boys, mm-hmm. and she only had one with her today. And so it was really relaxing to just chat with her how things are going, and she was great, it was great. The other thing that I went to, it seems a long time ago now, was right after our last board meeting, I went to the Beauty and the Beast, the middle school musical. It seems a long time ago, but it was, you know, I guess 4 weeks ago. And that was very good, very well attended. I went to the last performance, the Saturday night performance, and it was wonderfully done for middle school. I guess you always have to qualify things a little bit. Lots of participants. I don't know how many students were involved. It seemed like hundreds, but probably not that many.
And that's close volunteer.
To probably close to it, yeah.
That's volunteer, isn't it? That's not part of a class. It's not a requirement.
No, they do.
It's an extracurricular, isn't it?
Extracurricular, yeah. So there, and of course, there are lots of people involved, the directors and choreographers and lighting people. And I don't know them all. A lot of them were up on stage at the end to be congratulated. And so it was really fun. It's really nice. I mean, I don't know how long we've been doing middle school musicals, how many years, but I know it's a relatively new, because back in the day we never had any musical until they got to high school, and now they're doing all of the same kinds of things at a, you know, middle school degree and getting prepared for the next. Oh, it's great. It's just like any other transformation. You get them going young, and then when they get to high school, they have a pretty good idea. But because they do the same sorts of things, you know, set changes, costuming, design, all of that is part of what they're doing. So it was fun. Beauty and the Beast.
make a formal school visit. I did have the opportunity to attend the jazz concert the other night, which included at the high school both the choral groups and the band groups. Overall, very well done. It was held out in the commons, which is a little different, but they did that in part due to the projected number of people in attendance. I would look a little lost in the PAC, but they also, the student council was selling sodas and coffee and cheesecake and things such as that as a fundraiser. So it was a unique setting. The kids did a very good job, and it was an enjoyable evening. Also, just as a real quick sidebar, because I know we have a lot of things to address tonight, the last couple of times that I've been out at the athletic fields at the high school, they have had anywhere from two baseball games, a softball game, and five-way track meet going on at the same time. You can't even park anywhere near the entrance to the fields. And it was just absolutely wonderful to see the facilities being used. There was another day in which there were those items as well as a couple of soccer, instead of the track, there were multiple soccer games going both at the main field as well as out beyond Ava King Road. And so it's just a lot of times we're there and we don't see those facilities being used. It was actually fun to see them being used that much despite having to walk about a mile and a half to get there. So.
Wasn't the shuttle running?
Not on my schedule.
Do they still use the gator to shuttle people?
They do, yes. But not from the other end of the parking lot.
Oh, well, you look like you could probably walk.
Well, I needed to.
It's like a community of people out there.
Pardon?
A community of people out there just walking and enjoying times.
Well,
there's people walking the trails.
I was talking to Carl, and he estimated with spectators that one of those days there would have been more than 1,000 people out there. Pretty amazing.
That's it. Committee action and reports. Student Services Committee.
Okay, the Student Services Committee met last night. Most of the board was in attendance. And we have some items that we need to vote on. As many of you know, this is sort of the annual report on a number of areas, and the first had to do with our lunch program, our breakfast and lunch and meal program. And and Darlene is here, and Carl Hayek helped with the report, so if I miss on any of the numbers here, they can help me a little bit. But the first action item that we have is to set the breakfast prices for 2015-16, and we got a report on that. And in the end, we need to raise those, or we're proposing to raise those basically a dime for next year. Early childhood through grade four will be $1.04, from $1.40 to $1.50. Grades 5 through 8 from $1.40 to $1.50. Grades 9 through 12 from $1.45 to $1.55. The reduced and free, of course, would be no charge, no change, and adults from $1.90 to $2. And to make that in the form, and I would make that in the form of a motion.
Excuse me, Pat, the minutes are at your place in case you haven't, they should be now.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
Corner, so. And that is a committee motion, so there's no second needed, it just needs a voice vote.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
And we're splitting these. The next one is lunch prices, and I would make this in the form of a motion, again with the same data that Darlene presented to us. Early childhood to grade four from $2.50 to $2.60, grades 5 through 8 from $2.65 to $2.75, grades 9 through 12, $2.80 to $2.90. Reduced meals would be at 40 cents, which is the same for 15-16 as the present year, and adults would raise 15 cents from $3.40 to $3.55, and I would present that in the form of a motion.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
By the way, milk prices would remain the same, and that doesn't need approval, but just for informational purposes, it remains the same next year as it was this year at 40 cents. The next item was actually a very positive item that we all found out about it, and that is that the school district, is going to enter into a summer school breakfast and lunch program that's being offered to the participants in our summer school program. So breakfasts and lunches will be served for those who are participating. And before we vote on that, I thought maybe Darlene, because not everybody was at the meeting, could take a minute and just explain how that's going to work to the best of your knowledge.
It's called the Summer Food Service Program, and the reimbursement rates, I think, should be in the packet for that. Anybody in the summer school program for the 2 weeks, June 15th through the 26th and August 3rd through the 14th, are eligible to come to be at the learning center or the middle school and come and get a grab-and-go breakfast, which would be a muffin, a bagel, cereal bars, and things that are easily portable to take to the classroom or even the commons. And then that will be from 7:30 to 8:15, and then approximately 10:45 to 11:15, we will be serving lunch to all the students there too. So again, it will be something very portable, easy to handle, and easy for them to eat. So they'll have two breakfasts and lunch. So when they leave summer school at 12:30, they'll then bed. So.
If we show up, can we eat breakfast?
You certainly can.
Register for a fast.
So I missed the meeting last night, so this is free?
Yes, we qualified under what's considered a census data. Even though our free and reduced is not quite at 50%, it's like around 40. Uh-huh. They did a census data where they look at the surrounding people in the learning center, the middle school fell into that. Uh-huh. That area. So it's good for 5 years once we're approved. So I've been working on the contract to get all of that underway, and so that's due Friday. So
is this a state or a federal?
This is a federal program. So,
so this is something new?
For us, it's new, yes.
The first time we're eligible due right. to the poverty levels.
Oh, great. And how'd you find out about it?
I got an email from a consultant from the DPI late in February saying, you're now eligible for the summer food service program. And I said, how can that be? Our numbers aren't there. And then she showed me that we were in the census data. So I started uh-huh. looking into the program, and there's other programs out there. Uh-huh. It's not just this one, but this one fit the best needs of the mm-hmm. district versus the other ones. So there's closed sites, open restricted. There's all sorts of things. So this one fit, I felt the best needs of our, yeah.
Thanks
so.
For doing that.
Yeah, you're welcome. First go around, we'll make it work. So.
And just because the meeting is being publicized, just for the record, this is a program that will be no cost to our district, basically because it's funded by the federal government, and it's no cost to the participants, the students who participate, and all of our students who participate in a summer program, including, as we mentioned, some of those that we're going to have joining with like swim lessons and whatnot, qualify for these meals, which would be great. And we'll do the best we can to get that information out. I saw it was on the online this morning already, which was great because it's wonderfully positive news for everybody because it's such a great lift for people who are involved in those programs, especially if they're for length of time. They'll come early in the morning and stay throughout. And I think you mentioned last night, if I'm not mistaken, there's no ceiling to the number of people. I mean, if you have 300 students, that's fine.
If they're enrolled in the program.
Yeah, enrollment-wise. So if our enrollment next year, because it's a 5-year, we're up, it's still going to be the same. Yeah, so that's great news, too, and hopefully our enrollment will go up.
I'd like to clarify one of the questions that were asked last night about the swimming lessons.
Okay.
And I've heard from Ms. Bukart that the meals have to be served on-site. So our swimming lessons are not run on our summer school schedule. They're run on the city schedule, although they're a part of our summer school. So those kids are eligible, but if they go from home to the beach, back home again, they're not going to be getting a meal. We can't okay. deliver the meals there right. to them. In addition, some of their lessons will run at a time when our summer school is not run.
Yeah.
So we would not have it available
right.
at that time as well.
Yeah,
so.
And that's good that you clarified. I was sort of my understanding, as you said, they're eligible, and that's correct. Really all we can do at this point. And then the meals will be available at point X and Y, and if they participate during those times, great.
Right.
Yeah.
And That was great.
And I think we'll just mention again publicly, if somebody is from a different district or a different, out of our district, but is in our program during the summer, they also qualify.
Correct.
Okay.
And it's not really free. We pay for it, all of us.
That's okay, it's a good thing to pay for.
Yes, absolutely.
Well, since we're paying for it, it's a good thing that we're taking.
Taking advantage of it, you bet.
So that is a committee recommendation to approve that program.
Yes, I'll make that in the form of approval that we enter into a summer school breakfast and lunch program.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, moving out of the breakfast program for the last item that we have here, we got a report last night as well on the transfer, from the transportation, and I know Lee is here today, he wasn't able to come last night, so there might be some questions of him, but basically, the school district is selling three buses, and they're listed for you there by year and numbers, and the dollar amounts, each of them approximately $3,000 to $3,500, and so the district is in the process of selling them. We had some questions last night, and maybe you heard Lee, basically, these are older buses that have, for whatever reason, are not worth us refurbishing them in the district, so you're basically selling them to private parties. And we bought some new buses, or budgeted for them in our last budget go-around, so these will be replaced by new ones eventually, is that correct?
That is correct.
Okay. So, having said that, I would enter into, or make a motion that we sell the three buses as listed.
All in favor?
Aye.
Anybody have any comment of Lee? Had a question from last night? Okay. And then finally was just the committee report in general, and I think you got pretty much the breakfast and lunch offering information as Darlene gave to us last night, and also Carl did a good job of giving us the transportation. So all in all, we're in pretty good shape with both of those areas.
Nice breakfast.
Question.
So we have been anxious to get food into our summer school program. I know we talked about busing too. Are there any programs out there like free that we're paying for but we could take advantage of that do busing for summer school?
Not free.
Not free. Oh. So there you go.
Oh, we're not that lucky.
We're not that lucky.
So,
okay.
So how does that work though in other districts? I mean, where would the cost, I mean, do they get no compensation for that for summer school that you're aware of?
I have not spoken with other districts in that regard. I mean, it's just been part that has been budgeted and allocated to transportation, and that those funds are allocated to be used during the summer transportation.
I guess.
So.
Okay. There would be transportation aid for miles, but there's still a cost.
It's still very low.
I see.
Other districts, the one that was brought up does not transport students from home to school. The transportation is from one elementary school into the city, as opposed to picking up kids at home. So that's the simple transportation offered in that district. Our costs for summer school, we pretty much break even. And if we were to have transportation, we would do it at a loss.
Okay. Before we move on, there was just one question last night. I think Carl might have said maybe you might answer. We asked, you proposed for the next year, or this would be 15-16, that we would probably see a reduction in cost for fuel because of the leveling off of the diesel fuel. And you put in, I think it was $43,000. I forget what that number is. Is that correct? But we asked, was there a savings this year based upon what we budgeted and what we actually spent?
Absolutely, there was.
That's what we figured, but Carl, I asked, he didn't know. Can you give us an idea what that was?
That figure is just under 30 grand.
Just under 30. So in the next, this year and next year, we're looking at somewhere in a $70,000.
That's correct.
Yeah, great.
Is part of that due to the reduction in the number of routes that you're running?
Not for this academic, because we ended the 4K.
But for the next one.
For the next academic year as well.
Great. We don't anticipate our costs actually going down next year as much as our budget will go down.
That is correct.
We'll budget fewer dollars for it. Our costs will probably be pretty much the same as they were this year.
But it's still nice to get those numbers and let people know that we are trying to save whenever, and that certainly helps.
Certainly does.
Certainly helps. helps.
Well, you could see in Mr. Nookie's report that there, he's trimming our costs every corner.
Yeah.
And from buying parts to consolidating routes without adding time to routes. So every effort is being made. He's doing a good job of that.
Thank you.
I have one more question. Don't we operate our summer school program at a loss?
I laugh because there's so many different ways of calculating that. Our summer school.
I mean, it costs us money, doesn't it?
We get state aid on our attendance. Mm-hmm. So what we try to do is the state aid that comes in from our students pays for our summer school program, and we try to make that a wash. Mm-hmm. As it is right now, because of the rates that we're paying for instruction, we are operating at a loss, not a significant loss, but at a deficit. But we think it's worth it at this point.
But I mean, that would be an argument as to why do transportation, because
we're already at a deficit, right.
Absorbing costs.
May sure, I add yes, one comment? Please, just a comment about the lunch prices, just to make it clear that the reason that we're increasing the prices is due to federal requirements and a formula that they provide us with to ensure that the free and reduced lunch program isn't subsidizing our other meals.
Yes, thank you for doing that. We those of us last night at the committee got that report. And, so
but to clarify, only 4 cents of that 4 or 6 is due to the calculation. Which is it, 4 or 6?
We would have to raise prices 4 cents.
We'd have to raise 4 cents for the calculation. Okay. We're raising 10 cents because of the increased costs. Right? So it's a split.
And I think as long as you mentioned that, we did get a great report for those of you who weren't here last night, also on what our food service is trying to do to work in the farm to school programs and to incorporate as much other quote unquote natural foods or wholesome foods as possible. And that was all part of the report last night. So publicly, it's important to get that information out. It wasn't just numbers, but it was the whole program itself. And did a real nice job of that, thank you. And that's all I have for the
good report. Thank you.
I'm gonna go on to future dates. And there are some that I even added today. Tuesday, May 19th, you all received today through an email invitation to Science Day at the high school. That's on Tuesday, May 19th. And there are different activities going on in the different classes, science classes throughout the day. So check your email for that.
Is it later on today?
It was later on today, afternoon anyway, that it came out. But there is a whole schedule of things, there's some pretty neat things that they're doing as part of that. Saturday, May 30th is graduation ceremony at 7 p.m. at the high school. Temperatures in the low 60s, forecast. Tuesday, June 2nd is the end of the year staff recognition. That begins at 7:30 a.m. at the high school. You usually designate a particular board member with the initials Betty Mannion to speak at that.
Which one?
Or Connie.
Or Connie, that's right. Connie was last year at the breakfast.
She's going to take another run at it?
Very well received.
It was
last
really
year.
Good. It was very good.
See, and now I feel like I'm under the gun. I can't do it. It's too much pressure.
No, I would be happy to try again. I'm going to preface it, though, that it's not going to be as good. I don't want anybody getting their hopes up.
Well, we just expect new material.
Yeah, don't pull that over now.
We forgot what you said last year.
See, I'm counting on that.
Our regular board meeting, a reminder, on June 9th is at 7 a.m. And then on the evening of June 9th, just so you don't think you get an evening off, we have scheduled the Joint Districts and School Boards dinner with legal counsel, beginning at 5:30 registration, 6 o'clock dinner and presentation, and it will be at Simpsons. Jim Macy and Bill Bracken will be presenting. If you have any particular topics you would like them to address, let me know. Currently, the two will be board member email accounts through the district and the open records law, so they'll be able to update you on that issue, which we talked about recently.
And I've asked them to talk a little bit about the new issues that are coming to schools and currently we need to address soon, and that's the transgender policy for transgender students and adults who attend our schools for events. So those are the two topics they'll be talking about. There's room for more. If you have a, something in mind, let me know.
Dr. Peschel, I'd like to take this time to invite school board members to attend on April 20th an altered driving May 20th. And the FFA is putting on in the teacher's parking lot. And we did this about 5 years ago. And this year, the entire high school student body is invited to come out. And we're going to have like two vehicles in a wreck. And we're going to have like a scenario before the whole thing. And it will be like kids texting or talking on their phone and maybe having a couple drinks, leaving a party, kind of like all the different ways any of us can be distracted as we're driving. And then we're going to have for example, like the protocol that all the emergency services come through. So it's kind of a practice for them. So, you know, we'll have our liaison officer there first, and then other police will come, and then the ambulance will come, and then the coroner will come, and Fight for Life will come. And we're going to have a judge talk about the legal and financial consequences. And then we are blessed to have a friend that is going to share her story that she got in an accident years ago, and she's wheelchair bound, and because they weren't being safe in the vehicle, and that's how we end it. And when she speaks, you know, she still has tears in her eyes, and that's how we end it. So if any of you guys have time in your schedule, I would love for you to come.
What time is that?
Starts at 1.
Did you say you sent it to our email?
We didn't. I didn't, but I could.
Is this similar to the time when we moved all the bleachers out? Remember, we moved the bleachers out and the students sat there. This would be a similar kind of, okay.
Correct.
So the whole student body will be out there once.
This year, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, that was all 5 years ago, was it, something like that? Something. And it was like juniors and seniors, and Mr. Becker asked if we could have everybody out there. But whatever he says, you know, like
that. Oh, yeah, sorry.
I'm not signing anything.
You got it on tape.
Okay, that takes us to board monitoring. Julie Iden is here. We did want to schedule this a little bit later. She had another meeting she was attending at the library board, and as a part of the library board, so we appreciate her being able to come over here after that. There's a request made by board member Pat Fair earlier in the year to hear more about our technology vision. So we added infrastructure and funding as part of this presentation as well. So here to give you that is Julie Iden. She is our district technology coordinator. Julie?
Our vision, Dave, if you go up to view, there you go, and present. For the school district, actually was put together our technology vision. For the school district was actually put together back in the 90s, and we revisited it in the last 15 years, and we found it to be, except for a few word choices, very applicable to where we are today. And this is where our vision is today. School District Waupaca will provide a learning environment enhanced through technology to make teaching and learning as powerful as possible. Within that vision, there are 7 district goals that the committee put together. And actually, when the committee met initially back in the 90s, you can believe it, we were so forward-thinking that we only had to add one goal onto that as we moved forward within the last 5 years and revisited it on our committee. So the first goal is to facilitate learning through information and technology-based student-centered approach. And I'd like to take a look at that with some numbers. First of all, within the district, and I didn't include office technology, I didn't include teacher technology. Every teacher in our district has a workstation. I didn't include that in that 1,777 devices. That is student devices. That is student devices, not devices that are sitting with secretaries or teachers or administrators. Of that, 1,090 are Chromebooks, 171 are iPads, and 516 are computers. Chromebooks have been in our district really only 2.5 years, and so you can see that in 2.5 years our base of Chromebooks has grown tremendously, and we'll talk a little bit about why that's happening later. We still support 13 workstation computer type labs in our district, as well as some mobile labs with Chromebooks and mobile labs with laptops. As I mentioned, every teacher in the district has at least one computer workstation. Some of our teachers teach in a number of different areas. They have classrooms and offices, or a number of different classrooms, and we provide a workstation in each one of those teaching areas so that they are not without technology. Our teachers depend on technology not only for teaching but for their administrative duties, and they cannot really be without that. Some of our teachers teach in 3 or 4 different buildings, and in those cases we are not providing a workstation, but we're providing a laptop so they can take that technology with them as they go. When we look at teaching and learning, we're looking at 83% of our classrooms have a projector attached to that workstation so that the teacher can use that to do whole group instruction like we're using this year. 100% of the labs have projectors so that they can teach whole group. Interactive whiteboards in our district really came in more than 5 years ago. We have most of our elementary and middle school classrooms have interactive whiteboards, and where teachers at the high school have asked for an interactive whiteboard, those have been placed there. 66% of our classrooms in our district have interactive whiteboards. Document cameras, and a document camera can be hooked up so that if I were teaching now, I could put this underneath the document camera. It could be a book, it could be a worksheet, and then that would be displayed up on with the projector. So that's what a document camera does. It also has the ability to take pictures. My elementary librarian uses the document camera. Instead of sitting in front of a group of kids with a book on her lap and reading this way with a group of kids in front of her, she will put the book underneath the document camera, and then that book is displayed so there isn't any child in that room that can't see the pages of that book. My science teachers are in the high school are using, every single one of them has a document camera, and they're using it for dissections and those types of things where they can say, oh wow, we are just dissecting this today, and this third hour has the best example of this organ or this whatever, and they can then take a picture of that and show it for the rest of the day and go through the dissection with the rest of the class. So document cameras have really come into play in a number of very strategic classrooms, and 50% of our classrooms have document cameras for the teachers to use. We have used document cameras from science and that the other really unique area that we've used document cameras is I had a music teacher that wanted to teach specific keys in a keyboarding class. She had the students on keyboards and she was on keyboards, but she wanted the kids to see her fingers. And so we set up a document camera so that it would show her fingers as she was typing, or not typing, but keyboarding on her electronic keyboard, and then the kids could actually see that up on the board and see exactly what was going on. So that's an example of how we're using some of that technology. Continuing with goal number one, the technology devices enable us to infuse that educational technology and media into the curriculum. encourage active student participation in learning. You know, it's one thing to stand up in front of a class and just talk. And it's another thing to have every student in the class open up their Chromebook and actively participate. And that teacher has already sent out that assignment, so the student just needs to open up their email, pick up that assignment. Every student has it at the exact same time. When they are turning in that assignment, again, it's not putting it in the basket on the desk anymore, but it's sending it back electronically. And many of our classrooms have moved to that paperless style of teaching in terms of that. It complements our current teaching strategies, that teachers don't have to be right up here. If there's a question in a class, if a map changes because of a war or a border change, because of a peace treaty or whatever, they can look at that immediately using the technology that they have. Every single one of our high school social studies classes right now has a lab of Chromebooks that they can use on a daily basis to send and receive assignments from and to the from the teacher to the students and then back to the teachers. Our middle school classes have a lot of technology. A lot of the Chromebooks went to the third and above classrooms. So third grade and above. Our second grade received Chromebooks. They have a set of Chromebooks to use in their classrooms this year. Because our online assessments, the students needed to have keyboards and they needed to be able to type. And so we're actually teaching typing down to the second grade now, because when they hit third grade, they have to take an online assessment. And within that assessment, they have to do some typing as an answer. It's not just multiple choice. Getting back to my enable to up here, attend to diverse learning styles and multiple intelligences, enhance classroom instruction, and it definitely encourages cooperation. We have become a Google school. We have been a Google school for a number of years now, and cooperation in that I can send out an assignment and I can have a number of people working on that assignment at the exact same time and adding to it and editing it is in real time. And so that cooperation is huge when you're doing those kinds of lessons. Our second goal, so now I've covered goal one. Our second goal is provide access to communication and information in the global community. And if you think about that, we truly are living in a global world, and all of our students and staff have access daily to internet-capable computers, whether they're Chromebooks, iPads, desktop computers in labs or in classrooms. All of our second through 12th grade students have a Google email address, so it's their personal email address that will travel with them as they move through school. And the last thing I put on here, because it was a significant thing for us, as a district, we have had the Cascade Distance Learning Lab for a very long time.
Yes.
And this past summer, we upgraded that distance learning lab from analog equipment, very old equipment, that moved with us into our high school to digital equipment. If you haven't been in the Cascade Learning Lab at the high school, it is really very nice with 70-inch digital computer monitors. And I think we have all the bugs finally worked out. Actually, they've been worked out for a couple of months now. But a very nice opportunity for those students that are taking those classes that are originating someplace else, or for our students to share some of our classes with other teachers.
We were one of the early districts to get involved in the second generation. They're still putting those in other districts this summer, so they'll work out the bugs on us.
Yeah.
Julie, you'll have to change that, all second through 12th grade students and school board members.
And school board members, that's right. Our third goal that we determined was to provide equitable educational technology and software resources. We didn't want to back in the 90s, we had the vision to not provide more at the second grade or the fourth grade or the 12th grade, that no one grade was more important than another. And all district students and staff are provided access to this equipment and software. Becoming a Google school a couple of years ago allowed students and staff access to very basic tools. We hadn't been providing them for at-home use. You know, students could come in, they could use the computer, but then their data was left at school, their computer was at school. If students have internet access outside of school, they have access to their Google documents, spreadsheets, slides, and drawing. And they have that ability to share and publish in school and out of school. So equitable technology, you know, our next step would be providing technology that students would be able to take home. But at this point, we're not there. Number four, offer students and staff lifelong learning opportunities. We really aim to teach skills and not specific equipment. In other words, we teach word processing and teach it one way in elementary and a different way in middle school and another way in high school, and we expose students to a number of different word processing programs. We don't just teach Microsoft Word, because I truly believe that fifth grade student or eighth grade student or even, you know, junior and senior in high school, by the time they hit the workforce and need to know to create a document, they may or may not be using Microsoft Word when they do that. And so we really try to remove that one specific program and teach a number of different programs and teach on a number of different devices, whether that's a Windows device, a Macintosh device, an iPad, a Chromebook. Students adapt very, very well, sometimes better than adults do. But we try to expose them to as many different things as they move through our educational process as possible. And the internet has democratized information access. It used to be that schools and libraries was where information was kept, and it really is no longer that. Right now, information is kept in these boxes attached to the internet, and you can really do research on any number of things and find that with an iPad or a Chromebook or any computer connected to the internet. And critical thinking throughout the grades, we're concentrating on that critical thinking piece, and that critical thinking provides them with the skills for lifelong learning. Our fifth goal actually was to increase administrative productivity. And most of the programs that you're looking at, most of the uses of technology at the administrative level weren't around back in the 90s when we came up with this goal. We recently, last year, moved to Infinite Campus. Infinite Campus we are using for our student information system. We're using it for our special ed documentation. We're using it for our food service, our point of sale, and our record keeping at food service. And all of our teachers use it for their grade book. So our report cards are generated out of there. All of our libraries now use one library program that allows them to check out books. It keeps our kindergarten through 12th grade on one program, which just a few years ago was not, and this program is Destiny. For our financial services, we use a program called Skyward. For transportation, we use a program called VersaTrans to keep track of routes, etc. We have a computerized security program that we've been using for actually the last 15 years, but we upgraded it with our security project upgrades in the last couple of years. For our web page, we use CMS for Schools for web page hosting and creation. For our maintenance department, they have SchoolDude for all maintenance requests, and they also have a computerized HVAC system. And then we are a Google school. We use Google Docs, calendars among staff to share data. We also have moved just in the last year to centralized printing and scanning. We removed about 100 printers from the district last summer and centralized printing to control costs on ink and try to go a little bit more paperless in terms of that. So I think we're doing a good job there.
Can I put my signature on diplomas? Apparently not. Okay.
I don't think you'd want it to.
You could put it on checks too.
Our sixth goal is to provide students and staff exposure to current information and technology. Current is our key word there. If you can imagine the computers that we're using today, the Chromebooks, the well over 1,000 Chromebooks that our district now owns and uses every day, every hour of every day, weren't even thought about when this goal was developed back in the 90s. The things that we have done in the last year, 2 years, 5 years, and it's a continual process, is increased our internet bandwidth in the district. 5 years ago, people were still using DVDs and VHS tapes. Right now, it is streaming video is the most used version of video to teach within a classroom. And with Chromebooks are all wireless. They don't even have a place to plug them in for the internet. They have a place to plug them in to power them, but not for the internet. So we have had to beef up our wireless access throughout all of our buildings and classrooms, and we have another upgrade slated for this summer. If you think about it, and this didn't come to reality for me until I was to a conference, and it was a Google conference about 3 years ago, before we were a Google school, and I was at the conference and the wireless was terrible. But they knew it was a Google conference. They knew all of us techies were going to be there. And then they realized that we weren't bringing one device per person. And they hadn't planned for three devices per person, because I have my phone, and I have my iPad, and I have my computer. So I had my three devices, and I wanted to connect all of them at the same time for different purposes. And that's why the internet was so bad at that conference. Well, when we first designed our wireless, we designed it for one device per individual. But we can no longer look at it like that, because even the students have their phones and their iPads, and then we're providing them with the computer. So we are really designing and putting our infrastructure in place this summer for three devices per student and per staff in all of our buildings, in all of our classrooms. So our wireless has been a constant upgrade, and I'm sure it will be ongoing. Our ongoing replacement of technology and infrastructure to stay current is imperative. The other big infrastructure upgrade that we're working on for this summer is the wiring closets, the backbones that nobody sees. We're putting in at our high school new switches, and our switches are key to be able to provide the wireless and the security cameras and the computers. And so if that isn't kept up to date, everything else fails. But that's stuff that nobody else sees. And we have moved to leasing agreements just in the last year, so that we can look at these as fixed costs over years, instead of, oh, we've got an extra $10,000 this year, we need to put it into technology. Now we can say, oh, we have these fixed costs, and technology will be current, and the cost will stay the same. And so we've gone with leasing for that. Our seventh goal is to collaborate with our community to increase the use of information and technology. You already heard about some Rotary grants this evening. We have gotten Rotary grants in our district in many of our buildings for laptops, iPads, iPods. And one of the newest grants was at the middle school for a 3D printer. Very, very exciting. We have a great relationship with our public library. They have done some trainings for their staff, and actually for staff outside of their library, but in other libraries. And, And to be able to do that, they have moved to Google. I have lent them Chromebooks. And we are looking at putting together a makerspace in our middle school library, and our librarian and Joan Holman, our technology integrationist, went to the library because the library had already created some makerspaces. And so there was some information sharing there. Does anybody know what a makerspace is? It's really exciting. Do you want to share?
Joan came to me, and as she always is excited about technology. It's a wonderful quality to have in your technology integrator. So she comes and says, this is my wants. I said, all right, hold on. Sounds all well and good, let's see what we can do. And then she started pricing those things out, and I think we spent $4,000 or less on a wide variety of cool things that incorporate what we've already been working on with coding and just kind of gets kids interested in learning about more technology things. And then came the follow-up was, where can we keep all this? I don't know, where can we keep it? And she and Sarah Hanneman, our librarian, found a space that is an old reference section. We talked about how the internet has democratized information. Well, the reference section became obsolete. People weren't checking those things out. They didn't need to be reserved in the library anymore. So we took that section, and we're looking at getting a kind of a glass wall so everybody can see in, and we can open it up during the day and keep it secure at night. But it's a space where all this cool technology stuff is found and kept and has access to, and classes can come in and learn in this space. Expand beyond that, but it's exciting, it's cool.
The concept is that instead of being given the answers, the students will create the answers. And so provide tools that will lead them in the right direction, robotics that need to be programmed, 3D printers that you need to provide the image for, and allow students to be creative in a way that sometimes in our classrooms we don't always allow, but there are certain students, and many of them, that excel. And so we're going to start at the middle school with our own makerspace in terms of that. So, and there are a number of other collaborations that we've done with a number of different partners between Fox Valley Tech and UW Stevens Point. But I just listed a few key ones that came to my mind here. So those were our 7 goals. Trends in education right now, student-created content instead of being handed content, filling out worksheets, to have a computer in front of you, to have a Chromebook in front of you, to create your own content, whether it be a media slideshow, a movie. Chromebooks have the capability of doing all of those things for a very reasonable price. Internet-based learning and publishing. Blended learning. You know, I'm sure in your position on a board, you've heard the flipped classroom where they do their homework in class and they watch videos for their homework. That's what a flipped classroom is. And it's a very hard to sustain model, but I do see within our classrooms, district-wide, blended learning, where you include online and face-to-face learning, where it might not be a video you create, or maybe it's a video you create, and then face-to-face, so it's blended. And so that's happening. Videos used in learning, we talk about streaming video, VHS tapes are out there from the 80s, and video creation for the kids. Measuring learning, we have just done the Badger Exam Dance and the ACT Aspire Dance. So all of our students, 3rd through 10th grade, have taken an online test in the last month. Online means they had to use a computer to do that, and hours of time in front of that computer to do that. Hopefully that data will come back to us in the form that we can use to drive instructions, but we as a district, have used the MAP test to drive instruction for quite a few years, 2 to 3 times a year for our third through 10th grade students, actually lower than that, kindergarten through 10th grade students. Mobile learning devices, the Chromebooks and the iPads are mobile, that they can be taken from classroom to classroom and into different lab situations. You know, 10 years ago we didn't have computers in the auto lab. This year we do. We have computers in the auto lab. Those kinds of things. And device agnostic. And what I mean by that is it doesn't matter what the device is that you put in front of a student, but the student should be able to use that device. And so we really allow a number of different devices and programs and software to be introduced to students. Open educational resources. Many of our teachers in the district no longer use a textbook, but find their resources in different places and then put them together in their classroom to provide the content and instruction that's needed. Collaborative problem solving, social interactions for learning, whether it's on a blog or looking at other people's blogs, those kinds of things. I think Facebook type social interactions are here to stay, and they can provide excellent learning opportunities for our students. The personalization of technology, the ability to provide that student their very own email address, starting at the second grade, that follows them through, and they can have that email address and keep their information there, have their own contacts. We talked about leasing and making technology budgetable and sustainable within a school's budget. We talked about makerspaces in terms of redesigning learning spaces. Gaming right now is huge in education. We have a great club at the high school, the Gamers Guild, and they are looking at gaming. We're looking at providing some gaming opportunities at the middle school in the next couple of years. Some really cool things. We've already talked makerspaces. But I need you to know that even though I am in charge of technology for the district, it's not about the technology. It really is about the students and the teachers and what happens in the classroom. Technology is just a tool.
Questions to Julie? Or before we go there, Carl, do you have anything to add about the leasing program? Do you want to?
The only thing I can add to the leasing program, Julie and her team does a wonderful and excellent job. We thought there was a point in time where we needed $162,000 worth of Apple computers that were all due at once. And we decided that rather than have that kind of budgetary money, how could we have that sustainable for, we went through Providence Capital, and they indicated to us that for $56,000 every year, we could get the $162,000 worth of Apple computers. And if we decided to change at the end of the 3 years to Chromebooks, iPads, or whatever else would be viable at that point, that we could have that flatline budget and still get that amount of product. And what they do is they also take your old product, they erase it, it doesn't stay in a warehouse, and they give you a market value, and in this case, about $26,000 back on that, and they resell that product to perhaps a foreign country. So there was a methodology to try to how to make our budget more friendly, and Julie and the staff and the principals were all amiable to that. And one of the other things we did is this: we believe really in site-based budgeting with our technology. Basically, all the principals they're in control of their own budget. They have, and they get it based upon a per pupil dollar amount. One of the things we thought was they were already spending money on technology within their own budget, but we decided that how much money are they spending roughly? So we decided to more centralize that, even though we believe in site-based budgeting, that the principals agreed to that we took $50 per pupil and applied that into a central budget for technology itself. And that's one of the avenues that Julie has to work with the principals and with everybody, the teachers and everybody working together to try to get the technology that this district needs, because the district does not run without technology. So quite frankly, those are some of the methodologies. And we also work with, as far as budgeting, we get federal government reimbursement through the C-Grade program. It's USAC. It's a program where we get a percentage back based upon our charter contract, our own contract, which is EarthLink, our WISNet, which connects all that. Julie, help me if I am correct on that. And so we get a percentage back, almost 70% back. It's a multitude of filling out, similar to IRS tax forms, and or perhaps for year, and they check and balance it. And it's very particular. They have very many stringent deadlines. And this year, they opened it up to another category that we could help build infrastructure components, which Julie referred to building those, the gadgets, and I have all the wrong terminology, but the gadgets as far as switches and closets and things such as that at the high school, that we can get a special, almost a 2 to 5 year window, I believe, so we can apply, we can get about a 70% reimbursement upon our population of students. And this year will probably be close to $138,000, I think, toward that. And then next year will be $138,000 probably again. So all in all, this year, with the whole E-Rate program, it's about $175,000. If you count the charter, the WISNAT, of those calculations, we get about $175,000 back if we do our job right in the business office. So it's that's what we're looking at this year, to help offset those costs.
As you know, the concern we have, none of it's easy, but it's easier finding the money to buy the initial computer lab than it is to find the replacement lab once that computer goes out. And this leasing opportunity gives us a process for doing that, so nothing has to get 7, 8, or 9 years old, which it has done in the past. Remember the old process of taking the old computers, moving them down to the previous grade level or high school, giving them to middle school. That's just not the answer anymore. So the leasing gives us the ability to maintain current technology at a level of pricing.
You wouldn't let us spend the money before.
You're right.
I have a question. With the high number of Chromebooks that we are using in the program, how often are we turning these over under the lease program then?
The Chromebooks right now, the Chromebooks are so cheap. They're it's a $200 unit that's sitting in front of you, that we are not, they're not within the lease.
That's not on the lease program?
Yeah, they are not
okay,
in the lease
program. When we started using these, they were relatively new on the market.
Right.
At least some of the initial ones. Do we have a feel at this point as to what their lifespan is?
The ones that we have that are used extremely heavily, actually our first 90 have been in use every single day, every single hour virtually, and we have taken one out of service. So they have, and they're 2.5 years old. So we have really done a great job of, you know, we've replaced screens, not a big deal, can be done in a couple of minutes. We've replaced keys. I'm figuring over the summer we might have some attrition, but they've been great. They've been great. So I'm
would
not
you project their longevity to be more than a traditional laptop just because of the lesser dependence on the hard drive, et cetera?
Well, and they have a solid state drive in them, so there's a lot less moving parts than there are in a workstation or a traditional. And so I'm looking at them to last 4 or 5 years.
Have we staggered the purchases of these?
Yes.
That we're not? Okay. Thank you.
Julie, I noticed in our consent agenda you put in your request for the summer help. Can you just give me an idea? I saw the hours and dollar amount so far, but how many people do you actually employ in the summer to help out?
In the past, we've employed 3 to 4, depending on the students that we hire. They do the unpacking computers, cleaning keyboards, You know, it's pretty laborious to sit down in front of a lab of computers and take a Q-tip and clean the keyboards to make sure that they're clean for the next year. Moving computers around will take computers from classrooms and put them in labs or vice versa, depending on usage, and actually doing that physical movement and cleaning up cords, making sure that the cords are nice and neat, doing just updates, just unlocking the computers and updating them, those types of things.
Yeah. And that's district-wide?
District-wide.
Depending on the students' abilities, I know they've imaged computers and
yes.
Erased computers or taken, started them over, so that they're,
yeah.
Absolutely. And those three or four people are not, they don't work 40 hours a week. That's dependent on their schedule, and we work with them.
Okay.
Very interesting.
Good,
thank you.
Good.
Thank you, Julie,
very much.
Thank you.
Before we get to the consent agenda, I have a couple of questions on the consent agenda. Before I do that, there are a couple of things I left at your place. One is a article from the Milwaukee Journal Sentinel. It says, at crunch time on state budget, tough choices on the education loop. It's a really good summary by one of the columnists at the Journal Sentinel. And I happened to hear him speak on a panel with Luther Olson and James Morgan just last week. And based on that panel, he came up, panel discussion, he came up with this article. I think it summarizes the dilemma the state is in the budget process and some of the tough choices are going to have to be made in the near future to come up with a state budget. Keep in mind, you haven't heard a lot from me on our status for the budget next year. I've been rather silent on it, but keep in mind we're one of the very, very few, and getting to be fewer districts in the state that has capacity under the revenue cap. So when the governor takes away $157 million from schools, those schools are already at the revenue cap. They can't raise any money to get that money back because we are $2.3 million under the revenue cap. Yeah, it's bad that the money's taken away from us and we don't get it, but at least we have the ability or capacity to raise that money in other ways that most districts don't. So when you see the article, letter to the editor written to the County Post and all of the districts, surrounding districts' names on that letter and not ours, I couldn't sign that because we're in a different situation. And my argument with the governor, with the state budget process, is different than the arguments that most people are in. But this article does summarize it. You'll be hearing a lot more about budget as we move into June and as the legislature starts making some decisions relative to funding for the school district. So I encourage you to read that. Also, at the corner is a summary of the summer school classes, activities are going on that Mr. Earl put out there. And I think that was it. So just want to remind you of those things. And then, Pat, your questions on the...
A couple have been asked. Julie answered one. I was going to ask about that. And you answered one or the other because you had preliminary approval of summer school staffing, but the sheet tonight
yes.
will show us. But my one other question, maybe Mr. Becker, you gave us a list in of the graduating seniors 2015 coming up, and the list is there and so forth. Can you give us just a rundown? I think it's 165 and a couple of foreign students. Out of how many? How many seniors were eligible at the beginning of the year and were graduating 162?
Well, you know, Carl and I just had a meeting with the seniors this last week to talk to them about their end of year responsibilities, and Carl summed it up by saying, he never remembers being able to say that everyone present is going to be able to graduate. That all of the students that we currently have in the building are within the possibility of graduating. That doesn't mean for sure that they'll all graduate. We have about 30 students who we say are on the bubble. They need a credit, they need a half credit, they need something in order to complete that graduation. But our policy is that if you're within one credit of 22 and a half and you have them in all the right areas, you walk at graduation and then you make that credit up during summer school in the summer. So we Betty talked a little bit about Mr. Peters' program with their WALC. It hasn't been easy to get to this point, but we are at a point where everyone that we have now can graduate. There are some kids that have disappeared.
Yeah.
They have gone off to other programs. They've pressed the home school button, as we like to say. They've stopped showing up at school. It's a phenomenon of turning 18 when you're a senior. The laws no longer require that they absolutely have to be there. We can't cite them for truancy anymore. And so we do have a few students that will show up as a dropout for us because they've chosen to do other things that don't happen at school.
And if you had to guesstimate, what would our graduation rate percentage-wise be this year?
This year looks really good.
There's three letters that went out notifying students that they would not be able to go through the ceremony, just primarily the employees. The ones transferring back came from another school, came here, now is looking at possibly going back to that school district. That's one that we notified that they won't be graduating. Two others, but one is coming back now and catching up on their work. So when you look at that, you're looking at probably close to 97-98%.
That's a best case scenario. If all of those 30 students who are on the bubble fall through,
yeah,
we could be down at 87%, you know, or even less than that. But they're not all going to fall through. I mean, honestly, there's a handful of kids that we're worried about. And those other 25 kids, they'll get their act together. They'll graduate. It'll be fine. We'll have to put lots of pressure on them to make it happen. But
yeah, maybe summer school.
But there's probably five that we could flip a coin on.
So they will go through the ceremony, but may not receive their diploma.
Correct.
And
those are two different things.
Yep.
You allow them to go through the ceremony, but they must finish the credits in order to get
there. If they're one credit behind at graduation, that they will fulfill that requirement over the summer.
How many valedictorians and salutatorians do we?
Three each. Three vals, three sals. It's a lot this year. We've asked them to keep their speeches short. I'm anticipating your next question.
You don't
have to keep his speech short.
Yeah.
Yeah, mine is. You know, with 162, that cuts down a lot. But if you've got six people talking,
three 4.0s and three 3.99s.
That's a good thing to have.
Yeah.
Robert, could you just remind us to this 162 approximately are going to graduate. What is that number in terms of our four classes at the high school? Where does that number sit? Is it the smallest group, middle group, highest group? Where are we?
It's small. You know, our other groups are in the 180s for the most part.
Junior class is larger than
junior class. Next year's class will be the largest.
Yeah.
Okay.
What was last year? How many did we have last year?
200 something.
Yeah.
That's right.
That'll make graduation go quicker. There's nothing. 162.
What did we say it was last year? It was just an hour and 14 minutes?
It was under an hour and 15 minutes.
Yeah.
How long did you speak?
Less than a minute.
Dave, I have just one more question.
Yes.
As long as we're talking to Mr. Becker. Mr. Becker, I was looking at the class three trips for next year that are always put in.
Sure.
And they're all pretty traditional. The only one I had a question about, because I don't know, and that is the music department going to Chicago with 50 students. I know they went to New York this year. What is that trip for?
That's a different trip, and they've done that trip previously also.
Okay.
Usually it's with the treble clef group, the women's choir, and they'll go down and see some shows, and it's a day trip. It's not an overnight usually, but it is outside of the state, and so it falls as a class three.
Okay.
They do it on a Saturday.
Oh, thank you.
What are the two FN?
FBLA?
Yeah.
Future Business Leaders.
Oh, okay.
So it's Teresa Duda and the Business Education Department that are taking a couple trips.
And are the number of trips that are proposed pretty typical to years in the past?
Yep.
Not much change.
No.
Okay. That's all.
Motion
second. We're not ready yet.
Is there a motion?
Yes.
On consent?
Yes, consent to approve the consent agenda.
Second.
Betty Mannion?
Yes.
Pat Fair?
Yes.
Sandy Robinson?
Yes.
Connie Baldwin?
Yes.
Kirsten Greenfield?
Yes.
Stephen Johnson?
Yes.
Steve Shamble?
Yes.
Motion. carries 7-0.
No, I'm not even asking for that. I adjourn for all of us. Very, very nice.